लैपटॉप बोल रहे हैं।
We should start now. Save. Good morning. Okay, let us start now. Can you hear my voice? Can you hear my voice?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
We can hear you.
Yeah. Now I am starting. Okay. A very good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dilip Chandranath, respected chairman of the session, Professor Ramesh Chandra Gaur, Professor Dean and Head, Librarian Information Science, Kalanidhi Division, Indira Gandhi National Center for Art, New Delhi, all the invited speaker, Professor Narendra Lakhar, retired professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Guwahati University, Guwahati, and President ISLIC, Kolkata. Other invited speaker, Dr. Sanjay Kataria, University Librarian, Bennett University, Greater Noida, Dr. Angsuman Sen, Director, Computer Center, and co-convener of the program. All the deans of school, head of the department, all statutory officers, other officers, staff of Assam University Silchar, my committee member, Dr. Mukund Sharma, Associate Professor and Joint Organizing Secretary, Dr. Mrs. Sumna Chakvarti Sharma, Deputy Librarian and Joint Organizing Secretary, Dr. Naveen Chandra De, Assistant Professor and Reporter General of the session, all the Assistant Organizing Secretaries, Sri Rajesh Rangappal Darthi, Assistant Professor, Dr. Apurva Jyoti Majumdar, Assistant Librarian, Sri Amit Urao, Assistant Librarian, and Sri Kallol Das Talukdar, Information Scientist. From Ravindra Library and Technical Support Team members, Sir Singha, Computer Center, Mr. Tushar Manish Sinha, and Abhishek Sinha, and all the valuable participants, research scholar, and students. I feel great pleasure in welcoming you all in this 1 week, Dr. S.R. Ranganathan online lecture program on research methodology and emerging technologies for managing libraries, online teaching, learning, and research, which has already started from 8th of August 2020. This is our third day. It is a moment for all of us that we are organizing this event to celebrate week-long program on the eve of National Librarians Day celebration, which will be celebrated on 12th August 2020. This program will cover the various aspects of research methodology and role of emerging technologies in managing libraries, online teaching learning, and research during this pandemic period. On behalf of the Department of Library and Information Science and Ravindra Library and all organizing committee members, and on my personal behalf, I welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dilip Chandranath, Chief Patron of the event, who has kindly consented, who has allowed us to organize this program, and we have actively taken initiative to start this 1 week online training program. I also welcome our Chairman of the session, Professor Ramesh Chandra Gaur, Professor Dean and HOD, Librarian Information, Kalanidhi Division, Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, for accepting our invitation to chair the session in this third day lecture program. I also welcome Dr. Sanjay Kataria, University Librarian, Bennett University, Greater Noida, for delivering invited lecture. I take this opportunity to welcome our another speaker, Professor Narendra Lahkar sir, retired professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Guwahati University, and Dr. Anshuman Sen, Director, Computer Center, and co-convener of the program, who has kind enough to accept our invitation to deliver invited lecture in this program. Finally, I welcome all the deans of the school, HOD, all officers, all committee members, staff, research scholars, students, and most valuable, our participants in this 1 week long online lecture program. So we have already discussed the format of our program. So I will now request Sri Kallol Das Talukdar to please introduce the chairman and speaker of the session. Over to Kallol Das Talukdar.
Thank you, sir. First of all, warm welcome to all the participants who are joining this program today. Today we will be having very prominent personalities from the library science field who will be enlightening us in various topics. I have the pleasure to introduce among you Professor Ramesh Kaur, who is the Dean and Director of IGNC now, and he's a very reputed person in the field of library and information science. He started his career in the field of library and information science, and now he is heading the Kalakosh division of IGNCA. He has been entrusted with various works in the field of digitization, in the field of library automation, management, policy making. He is significantly contributing in the field of digital archiving of the Indian culture and heritage, promoting open access, particularly electronic thesis and dissertation, preservation of Indian languages through language documentation and digital archiving, research data management and research methodology, awareness about the prevention of preservation of access of documentary heritage, particularly through UNESCO Memory of the World program, and many other such big projects. He was also associated with the UGC MHRD committee for drafting promotion of academic integrity and prevention of plagiarism in Higher Educational Institute Regulation 2018, now for which we are checking the documents through Urkund software. The policy was formulated and he was also the member of that committee. Apart from that, he is having a long experience in the field of management of library and information centers. He was also working as university librarian at ANU. After that, he again joined IGNCA, and he was also associated with Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and CSIR and Management Development Institute MDI Gurgaon, IMT Ghaziabad. So we will have a very good session with Professor Ramesh C. Kaur, and our next eminent speaker is Dr. Sanjay Kataria. He has completed his PhD in the field of library and information science from MCRP University, and he was also a visiting fellow in Harvard University. Apart from that, he has various awards and recognitions that has been given to him. He was a Satkal Young Librarian. He was the recipient of Satkal Young Librarian Award in the year 2012. Then presently he is working as a librarian in Bennett University, Greater Noida. Previously, he was associated with JP Institute of Information Technology as a librarian. And he was also associated with Banasthali University as a librarian. So he has given around 60 invited talks in the field of librarian information science. He has supervised almost 5 PhDs and many MPhil degrees along with PGD land dissertations. He is having approximately 35 research papers in journals and conferences. He has written 9 books also. So we will hear a lot. we will hear a very interesting session from Dr. Sanjay Kataria. I welcome him on behalf of our committee. And the third person whom we will be hearing today is Professor Narendra Lahakar, sir. He is presently the president of Indian Association of Libraries and Information Center, ISLIC. He was the former Dean, Faculty of Arts, Guwahati University. And he has worked as a Deputy Director, Academic Staff College, then as a University Librarian in Charge, Guwahati University, and Director as a Pre-Examination Training Center, and many other posts. He is having a vast experience of 30 years in the field of postgraduate and research levels university. Professor Lahakar sir has completed his master's degree in library and information science and PhD from Guwahati University. Then he was also a fellow in the University of Sheffield, UK. With a British Council Fellowship. He is presently associated with various librarian associations like Assam College Librarian Association, then Working President and General Secretary Assam Library Association, foundation member of Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library Foundation, member of State Library Planning Committees of Manipur, Mizoram, and Nagaland. Lahakar sir has authored and edited about 8 books on the subject and more than 35 research articles at the national and international level. Under his guideship, 21 research scholars have successfully completed their PhD degree. Yeah. And he has successfully completed major research projects also sponsored by ICSSR and UGC. Lahakar sir is also a recipient of a Satija Research Foundation for Librarian and Information Science Bina Shraf Award in 2017 in the field of towards his contribution in the field of library and information science. So that's all about all the speakers whom we will be hearing today. And over to you, sir, Professor M.K. Sinha sir, for further endurance. Thank you.
Kallol, one more speaker, Dr. Angsuman Sen, you may introduce him.
Yeah. Sir, I have forgotten about Dr. Angsuman, sir. Dr. Angsuman Sen, he is director of our computer center, and he is now heading various committees in our universities related to ICT and various disciplinary committee, then purchasing committee. He is associated with all the committee as chairman. And apart from that, he also having a vast experience in the field of teaching. Before joining Assam University, he was associated with a lovely professional university as a faculty member in the field of electrical and electronics engineering. And he has also written many research papers in the field of ICT and electrical engineering. And he is very active nowadays in our university ICT infrastructure generation and development and policy making. So I welcome Dr. Angsuman Sen sir also in this lecture series. And that's all from my part, sir. Thanks, and over to you, Dr. Professor M.K.
Thank you, Dr. Kallol Das Talag. Now I will request our chairman of today's program, Professor Ramesh Chandra Gaur sir, to take up the session. And sir, with this you start the session, sir.
Professor Sinha, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good morning, you all. First, at the outset, I must thank Professor Manoj K. Sinha, particularly, and other officers or officials, Honorable Vice Chancellor of the University, and other like colleagues and department colleagues for organizing or celebrating Dr. Ranganathan's birthday in such a great manner. I think this is the right day of giving tribute to our father of library science by organizing something very useful event, which is a very important topic. So, many congratulations and thanks, Professor Sinha, for inviting me to chair this important session. Last almost 7 years, I have been advocating this particular concept, research methodology, and the role of libraries in enhancing the quality and visibility of research by helping the researcher in many ways. So let me just give some introductory remarks before inviting speakers to speak. We have a very, very eminent panel and experienced professional like Dr. Lakar, a very young and dynamic person like Dr. Sanjay Kataria, and we have a technocrat person, a person who is very well in the new technologies, which are well required in the field of current during pandemic situation for online teaching. So it's a very right combination of speakers today, I think very well identified. So congrats again, Professor Sinha. So let me put your attention to certain things which are very important. Let me begin with certain regulations, and I want to clearly define the role of libraries in these regulations. In this regard, regarding the research or research writing, the first regulation came in 2009, in which UGC mandated that after the award of PhD and MPhil degree, the electronic thesis should be deposited in a repository called Sodh Ganga. So digitization of thesis, digitally archiving, creation metadata, and uploading in the Sodh Ganga is the entirely job of libraries. And I put up a model for this by implementing a lot of tools and technologies at Jawaharlal Nehru University. So every university library should understand this and immediately work on that if you have not done it. The second important regulation, which came in 2018, like this promotion of academic integrity in plagiarism regulation 2018, which I was the member of the draft. I played a very role in drafting those regulations. So there are a number of responsibilities and roles defined in that regulation for the various stakeholders. And in these regulations, I advocated role of libraries because libraries are domain experts in referencing and citation. So creating awareness about referencing and citation, training in various kind of reference management tools like Mandy, EndNote, or plagiarism detection tool like Turnitin, Urco, or Authenticate, training in various kind of referencing databases, so some kind of databases for indexing and abstracting. So all these awareness and training is very important. So library play a very important role in that. So library also play a very important role providing various kind of research support, research guide. Dr. Sanjay Kataria has wonderfully done it in Garnet University. He might be talking about it. Now, the third initiative, which came in 2019, June 2019, was launch of UGC Care List. UGC Care List is a list of reference and quality journals. And in this, there are two groups. One group is group number two, which contains journals indexed in Web of Science and Scopus. And those journals which are not part of Web of Science and Scopus and still are good journals, those are listed in list one. So this UGC Care List is mandatory for publishing articles by the Indian researcher. If you don't publish in it, you will not get a scope. So library can create an awareness about this initiative and also guide students and faculty and the researcher not to publish in predatory journals. What are the predatory journals? What are the various kind of quality research journals? Like how to find out a quality journal in your subject? There are different kind of Scopus is having a journal finder, Springer is having a journal suggester. Similarly, there are a number of good sites which provide you information regarding good quality open access journal and regarding other traditional and commercial journals. So librarians are the even journal citation report or web of science. So librarians should train them in these four areas and guide the students, faculty, and researcher not to publish in predatory journals, but how to publish in quality journals. This is a big role for the libraries, and every library professional should be aware of that. That is the second, third regulation which you should be aware of that. You should understand what is UGC clear list and what is the difference between a quality journal and predatory journal. So you should prepare yourself in that. Now, the next important regulation, or UGC has approved a 2-credit course on research and publication ethics. That was done in December 2019, and it is the syllabus is available on UGC clear list. So it is mandatory for unmute your mic. It is mandatory for each and every library and professional to understand this course. These course contents are mostly related to the domain of library expertise. Like in IGNCA, we have learned, as a dean, I'm responsible for 9 PG courses and 6 certificate courses, and launched 2 certificate courses. One is on research methodology, one is on specifically on research and publication ethics. That research and publication ethics or course is designed basically based on the UGC approved course. So each department of library science, my suggestions to Professor Sinha, that please make sure that this 2-credit course you should conduct for your PhD student. You should provide all value additions to those, and you can take help from the library staff in drafting and implementing this 2-credit course on research and publication ethics immediately. The last regulation in this regard from UGC recently, there is a definition of self-plagiarism, and there is some clarification on exclusions, and 14 consecutive words should be excluded in this particular area. So these are the regulations which university library staff should know, researchers should know, or faculty should know, everybody should know about it, and accordingly course curriculum should be developed. Now, moving ahead, it is important for every university to develop e-research infrastructure. What do you mean by e-research infrastructure? E-research infrastructure is something, use of advanced communication and information technology, internet, and other tools in enhancing the quality of the research, in doing research, in data collection, data analysis, in publishing and writing. So let me give you some step-by-step approach in various kind of e-research tools. So it start with searching, like how to search a good library literature, library resources, and how to search using library catalog, library databases. So we need to guide this that internet is not the only solution for you. Internet has good information, but library resources are the best resources because these are the peer-reviewed resources for making a synopsis or draft proposal. And also guide the students for the menace of Google. Tell them Google is not indexing 80 to 85% web contents. The rest 85% web contents are searchable through deep websites. So how to search deep web search using different kind of academic search engines, different kind of semantic search engines, different kind of other subject specific search engines. So guide them about how to search on deep web, particularly academic information and government. So that's the first beginning that help them in searching and locating and identification and also evaluation of the information, which is good for their research, which is not a good for their research. So kind of research guide, kind of search support services are required. Moving ahead, then tell them, as a researcher, first thing you should do, you register yourself on a registry. Tell them ORCID, ORCID is the registry system where every library, not just library person, but every researcher could register. There are a number of advantages of ORCID. And after registering on ORCID, you should also register yourself for ResearchGate, Academia, Faculty 1000, all these databases where you can create your research profile. Then also you should register on LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook for the promotion of, because research profiling is very important. So first you think of making a good research profiling. And then after that, when you are starting research, you should also know how to design a questionnaire using Google Doc or different kind of SurveyMonkey and all those things. So those kind of tools, designing of questionnaire, doing survey methods, and all those things should be educated. After moving ahead, the next important thing is that now you collect the data. How to analyze the data? What are the tools for that? You have software like SPSS, you have an R software, you have other tools, which even Excel is a good tool for data analysis. So you should tell them various kind of tools for data analytics. Now you are start writing your thesis. What are the tools for writing thesis? You need to provide them Grammarly for grammar correction and grammar checking. You need to provide them plagiarism detection software, Turnitin or Urkund, whatever you have for plagiarism detection. You need to provide them reference management tools like citation tools like EndNote, Mendeley or Zotero, and also train them how to use these tools while writing the thesis. Then also tell them how to identify those journals, where you need to publish your journal, and how to avoid plagiarism, how to put your research in a right domain, how to encourage the researcher in various kind of research writing, what to write, what not to write. All these things should be by organizing. How did it publish in various journals? By organizing author workshop, by inviting a editor from Emerald or from any other publishers. So after that, when your article is published, how to promote your research, how to enhance the visibility of research by tracking your research, on Scopus or on Web of Science, or by creating a Google Scholar account, or by having different means of enhancing visibility of your research. And then also tell them how to protect your rights, copyrights, intellectual property rights, various Creative Commons licenses, various kind of issues concerning copyright issues. Also how to file a patent, how to guide them in maintaining confidentiality of the research. And then after that, you should deposit their thesis and dissertation in the Ganga repository, and also create an institutional repository or data repository in preserving or self-archiving their publishing result and articles. So and once it is done, if they want to publish as a book, help them in converting thesis as a book. They don't know what are the requirements of the thesis in converting a book. Give them publishing contacts, also help them in rewriting the work for book. So that way, and last thing, data curation center. You should help them how to preserve the created data of the university. So this is a kind of a flow chart, a life cycle of a research. This what I have mentioned to you, this is a research life cycle. And every point, there is a concrete role of a library information professional. Today we ask that we should be teachers. Yes, we are teachers, we are already teachers. Forget about our some of the nonsense library professionals who don't understand the difference. A librarian or teacher of library science, there is no difference in that. One is teaching, preparing manpower, another is preparing the manpower in different context. So we should learn how to interchange the role of library science teacher and librarian. Ranganathan always said, my true true homage to Dr. Ranganathan, who always commented that teachers should go to the libraries and librarians should come to the teaching department, interchange their role. So that way we are one. I think we are divided. So on this today, Ranganathan's birthday celebrations, these are my some of the thoughts and messages on this particular topic, which I'm sure presentation will further explain in detail, because I have about limited time of 15 minutes given to me. And in this 15 minutes, I just try to introduce you this concept of emerging research tools and technologies. So we may call it digital scholarship. We may call it e-research. We may talk about scholarship, scholarly communications. This is one of the same thing. And librarian is the central or focal point of this particular entire process. That way you can prove to your university, to your society, that libraries were relevant. Libraries are relevant. And libraries will remain relevant forever. And I think we need to understand our role clearly, and we need to work on that direction. So I think these were my thoughts. And now moving ahead, we would like to start the session. And Professor Sinha, first speaker is Professor Narendra Lakhar. So Professor Lakhar has already been introduced. And now, Professor Sinha, would like to invite him for a talk, Professor, to start his presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for enlightening us about the role in promoting research, supporting research in the universities. And you have covered many topics which are really were great helpful for all the library professional, all the scholars and students. Definitely, it will help in enhancing our knowledge in this field. Now, I would like to request our respected Professor Narendra Lakhar, sir, to kindly deliver lecture on academic writing, referencing, and plagiarism. Professor Narendra Lakhar, sir, please.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. I'm very much happy to listen to Professor Gore also. He has highlighted some of the issues that I'm going to talk today. Actually, my discussion will be concentrated to two issues mainly, on academic writing in referencing as well as plagiarism. These are the two sides of our a coin. So actually, I'm a first user of this WebEx. I have used Zoom and this one, Google Meet. But let me see, I want to share my content. Let me try. You have the option to optimize, just.
Third number switch, sir.
Third switch, then.
Arrow, share content.
Share content.
Open your PPT in background.
But share content is not, this is, is it, have you seen it, Sinha? Is it okay?
Sir, in third number suite, there is a share content.
Yeah.
And, you can click on that and attach your PPT. So first you open your PPT, then go to share content.
I can go to screen.
Please go to the screen, sir.
Yes. Third in button, screen, there will be your slide.
Can go to the screen, yes.
Yeah, we are seeing now, sir.
Yeah.
We are seeing your screen now, treated as your laptop only, sir. You please share your screen. Yeah, yes. Thank you. We are seeing
now
it.
Now you can slide slow. So.
Yeah. No, in that. Now is it okay?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Excellent. I'm doing other in Zoom and other thing, that's why. Anyway, so thank you very much. It's a nice experience for me to talk to the issue. I'm thankful to the organizer for inviting me regarding this. Actually, referencing and plagiarism, this has been opted by me, as Sinha has suggested me to opt any topic. So, but yesterday I have seen in your program, referencing style, automatic style, the way it is done, three or four software packages are being consulted. Of course, I was not attending the program, but I have gone through your proceeding write-up, then I know it. My topic will be on that again. It may be repetition to some extent to some of the participants, but to what extent it is possible, I'll try to and list only important issues, and others I'll skip automatically. When we talk about referencing, one of the major problems that we face for the researcher is that now it is very much serious that you have to put references. Earlier, when I have started my PhD, for example, in 92, I have seen that only small information of a particular document that person is consulting is provided in the write-up. If it is so, then it will be very difficult. It is very difficult to identify, to locate a particular document that is being consulted by a researcher to get into. So one problem in case of online resources, of course, it is not a problem because online resources have the hyperlink. They can automatically go to that. But in case of offline resources, it is our sincere effort should be there for a research scholar to allow, or a writer to allow, or to enable other people on the content that I'm consulting of my writer. That is why nowadays references are giving very much weightage, and there are a number of references, there are a number of reference style also there, though the data are same, data can be, I'll come to that, what data it should be informed. But there are a number of references we can, reference style we can use. I have opted for American Psychological Association citation format because I have seen that it is the most used citation style at present, number one. Number two, if we are aware about a particular citation style, if it is not used, we can go other citation style, but the basic things will remain as it is. That is why I am expecting that our user, our reader, should be conversant with one of the style, to what extent it is possible, and they can go ahead. Nowadays, in case of online citation style, of course, you can change your style, whatever you are doing, but fed into the system. So in case of APA style, the reason, again, I'm repeating that one, it is from this discussion I have found that it is one of the most used citation style. That's why I have used that style. I do not have the statistics exactly, but most of the people are advocating for that. I've seen that. So this is one of the major issues. It's most of the things are we are aware about being a librarian and speak. Most of the things that I'm discussing, wherever simply I'm trying to organize the thing in a systematic way. Arrange alphabetically is very much common. More than one word by the same author should be enlisted in the same place according to the newest tool list. If there is no author, title should come to the place. And one of the signs I have seen, using of a person in lieu of and. If there are more than one author, first A and B, A, B, and C, that N should be that one. I will not take much time, which you know already. Another point, less than justified. I mean, I have seen that even if we are in a, according to a particular citation style, these are haphazardly written. Haphazardly, appearing. So if you are justifying left, not middle left hand, then automatically it looks good also. And it is a suggestion made by APA style. Capitalize only the first word. That is another point. You will feel that these are the things that you can do. But once you are really put sitting in front of a system, in front of computer, you will be in complex situation. What to do, whether it should be capital, whether it should be stop, all these things. These are the basic rule I'm talking about. italicize the title of the book, and title of the source. Either if a title is, if a chapter is there, if an article of an author, editor, or a periodical is there, we have to make it the source should be italicized. Do not create separate list. That is another people are expecting that people say that the book should be differently, periodical should be differently, newspaper should be differently. No, it's not that at this style. It should be in a complete one list. These are the information we should, because incomplete information will invite you our insincerity. Incomplete information will not allow the document. So that is why this slide we are putting. So these are the information, whatever it is possible. I do not say that everything is available in the document, but those information are writer, date. I have seen in earlier occasion also. And now people are very much cautious, of course. Earlier occasion, those when the earlier days, which are now in Sud Ganga website, you'll find that the information like date, information like journal article, in some of the cases it is missing. So we should be aware about this one. In case of journal, in case of web article, online article, exactly the same way as in a physical article, but if it has got sufficient necessary author and writing, if we can collect it, but along with the website, it should be there. Question of on which day the website is searched by me, it depends on the information that I am putting. If it is really a particular information, not the text, then in that case, the date of searching may be required, will be required. But if it is only information in case of definition and in case of other thing, then date is not so much compulsory as per this one. So this is two aspects of references. One is reference at the end in the form of bibliography earlier we did. Nowadays it is the word bibliography is sense toward references. In-text citation is also there. In-text citation enable us not for endnote on bibliographic information. Endnote is necessary. Endnote is bibliographic information, but for other issues, if certain topic is being discussed in my page, then it needs clarification, go to endnote. But in case of bibliographic information, earlier we used at the bottom of the page every bibliographic information, it is only repeating, but now it is only if you say that my information is in 2005 page in 14 pages, what is this author, what is the title, this will be available in references. There will be no issue. So the American Psychological Association instruction of putting this way, the author surname is always full, but forename is in what I can say, short name, AA, not fully, not Ranganathan SR, it is CL Ramamrita is not suggested. Ranganathan SR is suggested. So in this way, this is one of the major changes you have seen. This is okay, it is within bracket, it is okay. Title of the work is very much, it is in italicized. Then location means publisher, if it is a published work, then this is actually, it can be shared by you also, and it is the latest in 2018, the manual is published, and it is, we have collected this one, it has given, of course, in different sites also it is there. So this is how we are putting the, system. It will be, after 15 minutes of my discussion, I'll switch over to my plagiarism, how it can be there, because this is one of the major requirements to avoid plagiarism. If we acknowledge it in a proper way, we can, which is nowadays very much top at present. So, but one of the major issues I have seen in APA style is that there are three things that we cannot accept. Number one, APSL suggests that if the publication is other than UK and USA, the geographical country should also be there. For example, if it is Los Angeles, say it is okay, but if it is Delhi, then India should be there. But we do not agree to that proposal. Number two, APS style is completely at present ignorant about the, of course, I may have some limitation also, about the manuscript. Regarding manuscript, how manuscript should be presented, how manuscript should be referred in the system, we have to do in our own. APA is not much guiding about this one. Third one is, when a particular newspaper is appearing from more than one place, for example, you have seen nowadays newspapers are published in same newspaper is published from different places with some additional pages. If the information are in additional places of that particular place, it will not be circulated in another place. So that place of publication from where it is published, this is APA's ignorant about this. See, I have seen that, we have to see some compromise level. So in case of two, as I told you, in case of two author, this is how, in case of three author, this is the process, in case of three author, and with a comma, this third, second one is from three author. In case of multi-volume book of editor, where editor is there and where DOI is there, the digital object identifier, then I have not completed the DOI, it's a long number, but you have to put it. I will suggest to you that DOI should be copy paste, should be there when you put references. DOI should be copy paste, and it is a long reference. So in case of journal article, it's very much common. The title is always italicized. In case of journal article, the editor of the journal will not get much weightage, but only the editor or author of the journal is very much, author of the article is very much in existence. One thing we must know, that the word volume and number, VOL prefix, NO, number is omitted in APA style. Simply you put that number, you put 154, that is the volume. So you can, the word volume is being ignored here. In the same case here also, the word volume is there. And if it is a number is there, and number is continuing from beginning to end of its issues, the pagination, then you can go only directly to pagination, not even number also. If provided, the continuation of the pages are there in all the issues of a journal. It is sometimes it happens, sometimes individual pages are there, in case of number should be there. So the same way, this is for in case of two authors, the same way in case of journal article. In case of three authors, as in the case of books, except that of the sources, motivation and emotion is the journal. This is the volume, no term, no visual word is there. This is the pages. When you remember it, we generally use earlier, after one author, if there is more than two author, we put two A and B, but in case of three and more, we generally put at L or N. Up to four, it is there. One, two, three, four. Surname, forename, and middle name is in these initials. So it is continuing, number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Why it happens, actually there is a good explanation of that in case of combined author, every author should get a credit to what extent it is possible. If you put only one author, get credit, so they will not be indexed also. That's why it goes to 4, it goes to 5, and it goes to even up to 6 also. After 6, of course, you can issue that one. It has taken body. We may have some question in between. I'll come to that question also, that if such type of thing are automatically there in the online mode, so why we consider? No, basically if we follow things, then even we can go to other any software package. So basic things are to be known, especially by the LIS students. That's why I have taken the topic. Seminar proceeding also the same way. Magazine article, a bit different from journal article, but it is also in the same way. I'm skipping to that. Newspaper article, as I told you, September date is must in case of newspaper. It's a common thing. Washington Post, but where from it is published? This in my this one. In case of citation of someone, actually, given the reference of A, which information I have got from B. B has discussed about A. So in that case, I have not seen A. I have seen only B discussing about A. So I cannot give a reference to A. Reference always you have to see physically. First, here orally as cited by Brian. I have put Brian as the reference. In citation, orally discussion I can put, but in reference, because I do not find orally. I find only by this author. So this author will come to reference, which we generally took the mistake. All these things are there with my concluding that the best way to citation is to do it manually. If you do not do it manually, automatically also you can do it. In that case, if you go through website, citation style, there are lots of information, lots of sites are there, which you get the information in a proper way. That is one of the two. BibMe, I have gone through BibMe, I have checked it also. BibMe, of course, after 3 days, they will charge the money, fee to some extent. So these are the sites. And in these sites, we can go through directly to that. But my point, manually you do the program, then you will be in the safe way. And at the end, when your working is completed, you can use the database, which have been discussed yesterday. You can use the software package. So all these things are related to our plagiarism. If I follow a particular document in my write-up, I have to acknowledge the write-up in proper way to save us from the problem of the insincerity, the dishonesty. So I'll go to my second aspect. I'm skipping the first aspect in a speedy way because I know that these are the discussions our LIS people are doing always. Only we are refreshing the discussion today. So these are the website. These are the original site. This is the book already. It is available there. And it is available. So the next other side of the coin is plagiarism. Why? Because at the end you have seen at the beginning, in order to make this, I have seen that plagiarism, to avoid plagiarism, we have to follow certain referencing one of the factor. Actually, plagiarism is a similarity. I think in your discussion, some people will certainly discuss about plagiarism in detail. I am putting the height of these issues. I have seen that nowadays, our CRM is also rightly talking about the academic integrity in 2018. In UGC has given this one. Earlier, it was a very complex situation. Every university have identified the problem of plagiarism, but they cannot take a decision about to what extent the penalty will be there, how the penalty will be there, what the penalty, and whether degradation, whether this one, many things were in a complicated situation earlier. We are very much happy that UGC come forward and they have put a particular notification that this is the way that you can avoid plagiarism, the way you can search for plagiarism. It's a menace of academic world. Recently I attended one lecture, and that lecture said that internet is helping us to do copy paste. That means internet is giving up, helping us. That is, internet is a minus point. The other way, internet is helping us in identifying plagiarism. So it is correct. In one way, it is there. It helps us to do mischief. In another way, it also controls us. It also controls us because you cannot do now. Copy pasting you cannot do unless you acknowledge. Copy pasting is you can do acknowledgement. If you are putting acknowledgement, percentage may be more, they may not accept it, but you will not be informed. You have done whatever you like, you have done whatever you copied it. Our sincerity should be shown by way of acknowledgement to avoid plagiarism. These are the process of plagiarism. These are the ways of plagiarism, quoting directly, paraphrasing nowadays very much common, I have seen. Even this, my work, is also taken, but I have properly put the acknowledgement. If you put acknowledgement, you can do that. Paraphrasing nowadays, if you are working in a word processing package, you can change the terminology. If you go to a synonym word, for few word will be there. You say that it is my work. No, it's not that. You have to acknowledge it. Using ideas means actually exactly, but on the basis of the ideas, if you developed your own thing, again, I just want to remind you that apprehending that you will be plagiarized, apprehending that you will be in fault, you will not write anything is not the answer. You have to do, you have to write. Unless you write, unless you contribute, who will contribute? We are in the academic line. So you think you developed your idea on the basis of the available literature, and you develop idea, you write in your own way, on your concept, then automatically, and wherever it is necessary, you acknowledge it. You acknowledge it. Gore has already suggested about, pointed about self-plagiarism. Yes, that is also another point. You cannot plagiarism, whether it is from your work, whether it is outside work, everywhere there should be. How to avoid? Actually, I have seen in website, give the information. 6 points, if you go to directly to 26 way of avoiding plagiarism, you'll get the website. Of this, I have identified some of the points, and you can avoid plagiarism in that way. Attribute references, yes, that is must. Describe all sources of information. Provide footnote wherever it is necessary. Use quotation mark wherever required. Paraphrase the original attribute work. For extensive quotation, obtain permission, that is of course very difficult. If extensive quotation is being put from some sources, the plagiarism invite you that you should get the permission. But the question is there, you show, because you have to get the permission from the publisher or the author. In some cases, author are not the person who can give you permission. Publisher is the permission. So by writing, in the meantime, you will be over. So try to avoid extensive quotation. If it is essential, prepare yourself for getting permission. And in the meantime, publishers also should be cooperative in this regard, of course. Self-plagiarism should be avoided. Drawing and other illustrations, permission is essential in most cases. Identify what are the issues of plagiarism. You have to identify the different types of plagiarism. This is the note in 2018. even I was also a member of the plagiarism committee in Guwahati University before 2018. Very complicated situation. We have identified some of the work done by some of the very important people which are being completely plagiarized. 90% of work is plagiarized. It is already published. So we are facing a problem. How do we, you don't get the guidance. Ultimately, EC has suggested us to you put the guidance, you deny some condition, then you meet the conditions. But now, because of the situation arises, the UGC rightly come forward. You may be having that this one. The while cutting the this is specifically mentioned in the circular, all quoted work reproduced all necessary is avoided plagiarism. It is not all quoted work, but you have the permission. All references, bibliography, table of acknowledgement are not included in the permission. It is not mine. It is in the specifically it is mentioned in 2018 regulation. All generic term, law, standard. Generic term means, as I told you, any term being used by all the people, you can use it. No. And the right person to check mainly your guide, your person who is doing under you, to whom you are doing, or the people who are at the proper level, they can identify the generic term, and this generic term can be avoided without reference. You can identify, you can put generic term, standard symbol. These are the things which are excluded in plagiarism. In all the cases, you have to maintain the quality, and quality always help us to avoid plagiarism. And the quality, actually, I have identified few qualities, but you can go on adding that quality. What is a new to the subject? It's anything that you are putting new that can be properly identified. Relevance to an extension of existing knowledge is you can allow. You are beginning. Then you yourself can do the work in the next year. So it's an extension of the earlier one with proper reference that will enhance the quality. Research methodology and conclusion valid if RD will identify the quality of the paper. Clarity is your English. Because we are always, we generally put in English language in library science. Still, there will be Hindi also, that is another point, and local language, though myself is always preferring English language. So the language structure should be, even I suggest all my research scholar that once you finalize the work, you just consult with an English people, though he may not have the expertise in our topic, but he at least a general lookout of the English language should be there. That will certainly enhance the quality of your work. Sound logical progression and that organization. Organization of a work is very much essential as in the case of content of a work. Organized way, we the guides are always very much concerned about the organizing the work in which way. So currency of references. To what extent is possible? For example, if you talk about today, the current, there is no printout of the APS style after 2009. Now it is only available in web only. So printout is, so. But if possible, you go to the latest one. Authentic, this is a complete repetition of last line you see, follow a standard documentation method such as APA or MLA. That is one of the major requirement for us, that at least we should follow a particular citation style, and that citation style either manually or automatically it can be done, and it's up to us. But one point is that we must have proper information, proper data to fit into the system to have the proper style. It is discussing about the how the different plagiarism is being taught. These are actually, there are four levels the UGC has identified, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0 and up to 10%, 1 is up to 40%, 40 to 60% have the references are there. So you can go on it. In case of teachers, in case of, again, the extent of penalty depend on the person who is doing that and for what purpose it is doing that. That is also very clearly mentioned in this. Of course, it needs some more explanation. I do not want to read it. I want to skip it because my time is almost over. References. Lastly, I want to these are the citation style. You can follow this. And these are the site, ORI, these are the site 26 guideline to avoid plagiarism. If we are able to satisfy this one, we can avoid plagiarism. So, half an hour is not sufficient for us, but anyway, being a teacher and being, expecting that you know most of the things, I am just repeating the things in a proper, in a systematic way so that you remember what I, you just remember, you think about what you have done. And on the basis of that, I'm giving the presenting my paper, and I hope, and I'm very much expecting some of the queries, because if we put a whole discuss on these various issues in the platform, then it will be more clarity will be given to you. And in that case, which I am missing in my discussion, I can also clarify accordingly. So thank you. This is my presentation in a nutshell. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for nicely presenting your paper topic on academic writing, referencing, and plagiarism. So you have covered the APA style in a comprehensive way. I hope our student, researcher, and participants, they will get benefit out of it. If they have any query, they can write in chat box. And at the end of the session, we will take up the question answer session. So thank you so much, sir. Now I will call upon Dr. Sanjay Kataria, sir, University Librarian, Bennett University, Greater Noida, to present his topic, Managing Research Data Using FIXAIR Data Repository. So this is a very recent and new one, important data repository. I request Dr. Sanjay Kataria, sir, to go ahead.
Thank you very much, Professor Sinha. Good morning, one and all, Professor Lakkar Sahab, Professor Ramesh Gurji. It's really hard to speak after the speaker like Professor Lakkar and Professor Gore. But both they made my job very simple, and I believe that I can continue my discussion after knowing about the research, what Professor Ramesh Gore has already explained, the research life cycles and various steps of the research, and how the research is important, and the library is a librarian can play an important role in promotion of the research activity in the university system. So before starting my presentation, it's my moral duty to acknowledge my sincere thanks to the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Assam University, Professor Deepak Sinha sir, Professor Manoj K. Sinha, HOD, Deans and Librarian of the University, has multiple responsibilities. Professor Sinha is always very dynamic, very active. Dr. Rajesh Alrathi and Mr. Kulas Das. And last but not very important person of this seminar series, our student Tushar Manish Sinha, who's supporting technically all this webinar series. I'm really glad the student of Bennett University, where I'm serving and supporting all this, they're doing very extraordinary, and they're taking a very great benefit of this pandemic time, not only learning, but supporting that whole academic fraternity. So thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to share my views that Professor Sinha has already said. This is quite new area. This is new for Indian fraternity, Indian allies fraternity, but not very new in a Western universities, Western scholar community, because many of universities in UK, Europe, or US, they already started, and concept and exploring and applied over there. But therefore, it is very important because, as all of we know, let me save my slide first and then we'll continue. Is my PPT visible properly?
Yes, sir. Your PPT is visible.
Yes, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So that I believe that I hardly to discuss about the importance of the research and how the research, the scholar and the research scientist is investing their time, energy, and kind of efforts for all kind of research. Whether it's an experimental research or other kind of research, so there is a research project funded by some of accredited agencies, funding agencies. But what kind of research is very important, and how this research data, what I'm going to talk about. So research data is really important, and how the librarian basically can help research community, scholar community to manage the research data. And there is a various mechanism, platforms, where we can manage the research data. Like a FixDAIR is one of the open research data repository. So I'll be not only will talk about theoretical, I will not only say the PPT, but I will also demonstrate how a research scholar, a professors, a student, research scholars, or project research project people can manage the research data. So I'll be discussing about exactly what research data is, kind of research data, type of research data, and why should we manage the research data, and what is the basically research data management, how to manage the research data, and who are the stakeholders in managing the research data, and what should be included in a research data management plan, and finally I will be demonstrating the fixed research data repository. So research data is nothing but a kind of raw research data. Research data which is generated, curated during the research process. Say once research scholar started his research PhD program and start exploring the literature. Let me start to say the exploring the literatures, collecting and curating the literature from different sources, organizing that literature in their, helping of different tool like a Mendeley or other, or the different kind of notebook they use in the laboratory while they're experimenting. Or there's a data which they have collected from different discussions or through questionnaires or through, say, the observations. So all the kind of data is generated, curated during the research process is so-called as the research data. And you can see the definition given by University of Leicester and University of Sheffield. Research data can be defined as a recorded, a factual, commonly accepted in scientific community as necessary to validate the research finding. I must focus the research data is in a data which is helping the research community in validating their research finding. Again, the University of Sheffield, they also had discussed about the given the definition on the research data management. They say that research data needed to validate the result presented in scientific publication or the evidence used to inform or support the research conclusion. So you can understand how research data is important. Because without having in the research, raw research data, facts and factuals and all, the research data, without having a research, proper research data, that no one research can be concluded. Or in case somebody has somehow managed the conclusion and challenged by someone, cannot be justified having a without a raw research data. So in that context, I can say that how research data is an equally important as that you know your publication which you publish in scientific journals. So keeping in view you know, all these facts, I say that the research data is one of the important process, important entity of any research. So we should understand the importance of the research data. Now let us discuss what kind of research data is there. If you look at the research data, I as I said, and data can be any of data which is collected, generated, experimented, observation through observation or whatever. It can be the type of the data which can be used and can be helpful for the scholar to validate his or her research finding. So data can be numerical, like in spreadsheet, you as in a social scientist, they used to go into fields, they conduct in different kind of surveys, collecting different ways of data, and the data we are key in the spreadsheet Excel file, and then after analyzing the data. We have a different kind of experimental research, pure sciences research, chemicals, chemical reactions, composition of chemicals, and then again experimenting that you know kind of material through different kind of machines and tools, and getting a data through the experiments. That is a very important data, and that data only you know helping in further analyzing and kind of including the research. Computer scientists, they used to design different programs during the research. They design algorithm, they design a different kind of software or different kind of module. So that is also one of the nature of the research data. As a biological nowadays, people talking about COVID-19 vaccine, you can understand how that different companies globally has you know initiated after this pandemic, and how they are you know involved in designing the drugs and this kind of vaccines which can help us in the, you know just with this pandemic situations. And this basically while we are going to some of company, even I must say that like an I'm not going to take name of the company, and you are aware that a few months before that they announced that they have designed and you know vaccine for the COVID-19. But suddenly that again government has to control because there was no any kind of certification, validation and approval of that concerned agencies. Because once they are going to start you know designing and discovering that vaccine or the drugs, they need to start a different kind of laboratory experiment, composition of chemical materials, and then we are having you know after proper testing, proper kind of different stages of that you know testings, observations, and still there's some certification is required, some approval is required, and based on that you know they're announcing that this is the perfect vaccine, the people can make use of those kind of vaccine without hesitation. A lot of videos, audios, material, and any kind of notebook, laboratory notebook or sketches, different kind of research, having a different kind of research data. Scientific data has a different nature, social science people, they have a different nature. Computer scientists, they have a different kind of nature of data. But data, whatever data is there, data is very useful for any kind of data which is helping research scholar in validation of their research. So now this is next question, why we should manage the research data. If you look at in the right side, there is once research scholar who has lost their laptop, or so you know when you're going to start research in a university, years of years hard work, we have invested a lot of time, energy and efforts in collecting, organizing and analyzing your research data, and suddenly you're going in some you know traveling some places and suddenly go to misplace your laptop, and now you can see the kind of you know how that how you're able to recover and recollect the data again putting the same kind of energy, times and money you know generating and collecting, organizing this similar kind of research data. So therefore in case we are managing the research data by using different kind of you know research data repository, we are avoiding you know we are avoiding this loss of loss of data, and there is we can save a lot of time and energy. We can basically data what we are managing on the through the repository is helping us to reuse and share the research data so that research can accelerate further. And this research data is also developing transparency and given a kind of visibility, reproducibility of the research. And finally, there is a number of research funding agency, they also started, and mandate even when you are going to submit any of research proposal to any of funding agencies like DBT, CSIR, or ICCR. Nowadays, even this is not only India, but if you look at an international funding agency, they also have started asking the research data management plan along with the research proposal. So when you're going to start your research or you're going to apply for research funding, you should have to have your proper research data management plan. And this research data is also, in case we are managing the research data through different open repository, this will increase in visibility. And equally important as because we are getting a citation of your research data, and this will help us in many ways. Not let us discuss about research data management. Research data management is nothing, a kind of a process where we are collecting, organizing, preserving, and sharing the research data for reuse. And there is a life cycle of research data management. If you look at there is four major concerns for the research data cycle. This data management life cycle, that is planning, creating a data, storing, and sharing a data. When you talk about the research data planning, DMP, that we are starting from that policy which is really need to design properly, have an implementation of research data policy in the respective institution. We should keep in mind our integrity of the data, ethics of the research. And again, that need to have a proper planning and documentation of what kind of data has to be collected, who will supposed to make a documentation of data, kind of metadata, and when you're going to create any data, what kind of format and files is we required to the name of files, and kind of file format have to be used for the research data. And then when we are talking about the storing the data, that means we have to again see how we are going to secure the data, having a different kind of storage, internal storage, external storage, cloud storage, or we are going to put our data in some of the repository. When you're talking about the security of data, that means physical or electronic security, network security, we have to keep in mind all those kind of issues. Then once you're talking about finally sharing the data, because the research data basically management is in the basic ultimate purpose is the sharing and reusing of the data. So when you're planning to save the data, we have to keep in mind the ethics and copyright, who is holding the copyright, who is the person having the right of the copyright, the research data, and how data can be cited. All those information should be planned quite well in advance. So this is again one of the FAIR principle of research data management policy, and stand for findable, accessible, interoperable, and reuse. That means when your data you are going to manage and plan, then your data should be findable. That means that data repository or the data where you are going to store your data, that should have a properly maintain the your metadata standard, where the data will allow to get access quickly and efficiently. When you're talking about accessibility, that means data is available in open platforms and available for all scholar community. And every research data repository is supposed to generate an one of identifier, digital object identifier DOI, and so that data can be retrieved, can be used very easily. And then finally, interoperability means nothing but the kind of data should be in a standard communication format where data can be exported and imported, can be communicated one machine to another machine or one system to another system. Reusability, that means all data is clearly described in metadata outlines, associated data reuse standards. So this is the FAIR principle of data management process, and the Western, this European research community, they have designed this fair research data management policy. Now we can talk about who are actually ultimately responsible for research data management plan. So once you're going to talk about the research data management, that institution or the university authority is a first stakeholder of that research data management, because ultimately institution level policy should be really defined, and that should be applied properly. The people who are having a funding as a funding projects, who are the principal investigator of the research projects, they have a sole responsibility. Because the ultimate data is generated from the laboratory, from their sources, and they know the importance of data. They know the data about data, metadata, and they are supposed to, the principal investigator, the scholar, co-operative investigator, the research scholar. They know that the nature of data. They know the importance of research data. So therefore, they're the person who is the best to describe about the data, document the data. Therefore, this is the second stakeholder. And then third one is that research administrator of the Dean Research Office. So this is again the person who's ultimately responsible in promotion of research and monitoring and taking care of research activity in the university system are the main concern, because they ultimately have to decide the proper implementation of research data policy. IT teams, that means whatever IT unit in respect institution, they if in case institution is going to design their own repository or they're going to design their own system, that again the shutdown things is required from IT head, IT and all, also like a security and backup of the research, the data. And how you can see the put in a red text in the red color, the library. Library is playing again an important role in promotion of research data management policy. The research librarian can help the institution in framing and design the research data management policy, and can also create a research awareness among the community. Can also conduct a different kind of training programs for research communities, research scholars, and can help scholar and the scientist to upload the research data into open data research repository and tell them how to create any metadata of the research data while they are uploading the data of any of research repository. This is the data management plan, and there is a lot of many of institution, they already have been providing a standard template for the research data management plan, but there is a sixth main. Ms. Siva, can you mute yourself? Hello. Yeah. So this is sixth different step we need to take care while we design the research data management plan. First and foremost is the collection of the data and study material. That means what type of data has to be collected, how much data to be collected, and what should be the data size limit, and what should be the method and to be adopted in collecting the data or anonymization. So these are the few things we have to keep in mind while we are going to collect and research data. Second thing is that storing, security, and backup. That means where we are going to store a data, how to protect the data on the network network environment, how and when to take a backup internally, externally, or cloud, and then how to protect the data physically or the virtually. These are the again an important decision has to be taken at the time of designing a research data management plan. And then for first step is the archiving, preservation, and curation. That means how to archive, including metadata standard. What kind of metadata standard has to be used, and then what type of the infrastructure will be required for archiving the data? What type of the data must be kept? And how long the data has to preserve? This is a few questions which we have to keep in our mind while we discuss and design the research data management plan. Discovery, research, and sharing. That means whatever data you have organized, preserved, and stored, that means whether your data is accessible, shareable, or not. Because ultimately, ultimate object objective of the research data management is to access and open access of research data and reuse of the research data. That means which repository has to be used, or will people be able to find it? Repository should be generated, persistent identifier, that means identifies the data, which every data will get in a DOI. So the data will be retrievable, accessible very easily, and data access management plan. And then finally, metadata, who's supposed to design a metadata, who's going to document the data, there's some certain question in mind. And finally, while we are having a proper policy related to rights and responsibility, who's ultimately responsible for the data security, data uploadation, data documentation, and the data can be made open or closed, and which license is applicable for the research data. So this is some DMP tools is available. You can explore. Many of university, they have designed their data research management templates. The scholar just need to explore on this website and can make use of this DMP tool while they design a research data management plan. These are some of repository where we can use and can generate and can host and upload the research data. Like in some of funding agency, they have started their design their own repository, under repository, where that while they giving a fund to any of research project, they're expecting the research data will be uploaded on their funder agency's repository. And there is some institution, they have designed their own institutional research data repository. They're expecting that all scholars and community of respective institution, they submit and upload the research data on the institution repository. There are general repository where anyone can make use of this general repository and can upload their data, can preserve their data, can store their data. And there are some subject specific repository where that people can identify the different open data repositories there on different disciplines, and the scholar community can make use of this repository. And there is some country, they have started their own national data repository. So these are the repositories. Now, how to initiate a data repository? This again, I have to take a decision whether we are going to make use of open data repository or the institution is planning to design their own data repository. So I always increasing and going to start in culture in my university and going to create an awareness among the research community, research scholars, to make use of open data repository, just to ensure and that the data is safe, the data is secure, data is in a long, having a long-term preservation, long-term accessibility, and anyone can make of the research data use, reuse, and can share further. So these are some of our data repository. There are many more, and I'm going to discuss about Figshare. So Figshare, I found, is one of the very unique and very helpful and very user-friendly data repository. Any of research scholar, any of institution, any of publisher, any of scientist can just can create their account, can upload their data. So I was showing the repository this PPT. I'll be taking online practically. I'll show a few steps of the Figshare repository, how to use this Figshare for uploading your research data, for managing your research data. And you can see the sort of statistics is available. And good thing is that you can see here, this is the old screenshot, more than 5,000 citation of Figshare, more than 5,000 citation is received by this Figshare data repository. So that I must to emphasize that the way you are getting citation of your research publication to different scientific journals, again, at this, in case you are going to make use of this data repository, your data repository will be, your data will be used by other scientists, other scholar community, and can get an visibility, accessibility along with your citation. And this, your research data will impact of your research in global community. That's why every scholar must have to have upload the research data in the open repository. And now allow me to take this fix here on practical. And you can see that this was designed in 2001 by Mark Hellen. And he was in Imperial College of London. And this is again a free repository. Anyone can make use of this. And the simple thing is that just people have to click here, sign in, sign up. And what we are using in our different social media, just create your account from here. You have to fill some basic information, accept term and condition. And then just this screen will appear. And this is the workflow of Pixel data repository. Now I'll show you practical. So once you're going to start your repository, after getting a login, after logging, you will get into this dashboard. And here you can see different features: my data, projects, collection, activities. And here we can create, update our profiles. We can upload our pictures, some other information.
PPTs are not coming.
Oh, just give me 1 minute. That I have to resave the screen because I have logged. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, now it is coming, sir.
Okay, just give me 1 minute. So this is the basically fix here. When after creating your account, you can see here, this is your dashboard. And this is the tab My Data, Projects, Collaborations, and Activity. Okay, then I will be showing this step by step. You can browse your data, or you can search your any kind of data from here. Say if you would like to see the COVID-19 research paper, just put COVID and kind of see the kind of data is available on Pixel, because the last 3 to 4 months research data, you can see there are more than 2,920 research data is there related to COVID. And globally, the research is progressing. Because this repository is not helping to just store and preserve your data, but you can see that globally research is going on your domain, and where you can collaborate with the scientists, you can work together. And say you want to see this paper, just click here, you can know about the data, and you can see here. Are you able to see here? They see that somebody is, as submitted this, A. Anandan has submitted this paper. You can see it was posted on 5th of May, 2020. This is all metrics of the paper, and one person has tweeted. 1,252 people has viewed this paper. 335 people has downloaded, and no one citation so far. So this is the importance and the why I was talking about visibility of your research. So your research will be visible like in that way. Once you are going to start your uploading the data, and your data will be visible to all, and you can see that how many people have viewed your data, how many time data has been downloaded. In case any citation, can be shown the citation. Here is that category means that your research is concerned with the research category. that bioengineering or whatever. And you can see the here you can see that you know details. It was submitted on 4th May and first online date. And in case something added and someone is adding on anything on this paper, it again it is maintaining all the version of your research paper. And you can see here you can make a DOI. This is DOI where we can give a citation. We can just DOI and you can see in case Professor Ramesh Singhod was talking about ORCID ID. Here you can see the author ORCID ID. You can know about the author just clicking here. And even if somebody is want to use this paper in the research, just can click and export this this paper in all these reference work software, BibTeX, reference manager, and not and all. And this is the CC by 0 means that is available for use, reuse, reshare. And here we can download, we can share this data with anyone. In case I want to refer this paper later on, I can add here, collection means I can add it, this paper in my collection. So whenever I feel free, I can make use of this. So this is one of the example. Let me show you how to add your research data. There's two way adding in a research data. One is that individual scholar, another is in a research project. The people who's working in a group on a particular research that can be managed. Create a new item means here you have to upload your file, that file which you would like to upload in the system. I must say that this is the image of this today's program speakers at I must say that workshop title, workshop of on research method at Assam University. And this is by default is taking my main author. And if I want to add someone, I can add here in case I know the ORCID ID of any author, I can recall the author by using ORCID ID. Here I have to tell that kind of category belong to this. So this is the library science, library workshop. So I will say the library studies and all. Just click here. And then again it will ask type of the data. This is the image I'm going to upload. And again, I have to say here the keywords of the data, the research. Workshop. Assam University. Again, I have to put in a data about this is the poster of research workshop conducted by some university, something like that. And then you can see here. Again, it will ask in case somebody is, funding agency, in case this project is funded by someone. So we can put in a funding agencies, say Assam University, Assam University, Silchar is already there, Department of Biotechnology of your university, Professor Sinha, Biotech, Department of Biotechnology, your Department of Biotechnology of your university, they already using this fix here. Say, or you can create your own, and in case you would like to give any of reference your website of Assam University or say something like that. Again, in case any DOI related to this project, you can put here. Or in case references, if you would like to link of your this project to any of the link reference, you can click here. And here you can assign And again, we have to. DOI. It's asking DOI or link. Okay. So here you can see that license granted. I said the CC by zero. That means default license. This data can be reused by anyone. And good thing is that Professor Sinha, you can see here, applied embargo. That means in case your work is not been completed so as on date, and you would like to upload this data, and you think that the data will be on public domain after 6 months, from here you can put an embargo of this data. And in case with the reason work is still under progress, or if you would like to generate your private link URL where you would like to share your data, you can generate your data from private link from here and can share with any of this is the private link, and just copy and you can share with anyone. And if you would like to reserve a DOI for this data, it can be reserved the DOI, or this is a cancel DOI and here is my link. And in case you are accepting the publish, just click on publish. Say either please fill the mandatory metadata mark with the keywords and okay. Then we have to put the keywords and DOI. Keywords given.
Sir, it's not keywords, it is about DOI. DOI form is wrong.
Okay. I should not mend it DOI.
Named 10.
Careful, again is not allowing the keyword. Please fill the mandatory mark with the NFL file and upload able to make and public keywords. Keywords, why is asking keywords? Okay, let me show you from here. Let me already create this file here. That means this green signal, once you are accepting, I have to check that DOI issues. But once you are clicking here, that means publicly, this data will be in publicly and that will be searchable. This is one thing. And second thing is that, in case you had a collaborative project, people having their kind of people working together, They can create any project here, just add in title, description of the projects from here, funding agencies, and even a person can add an number of people together. Like, I mean, just want to show you.
Yes.
We create two project here and working on, so say I'm working with the Mr. Kulik Jamil Ahmed. If you click here and fix here, you can see again that you have to put in all the metadata about your project and can upload, and you can give your rights to your the person who's working with you, what he can do. He can upload or he can view only. Collection means something, whatever you are able to see, say COVID or whatever, say digital library, and some things you found useful, you can add that paper on your collection so that you can make use later. Say something digital, you would like to use this presentation. And you can collect. Plus means you can add here, or you can give a citation. If you would like to give citation of this your paper, see here you can see the different reciting citation styles is there. Even APA style is there. Professor Lakar was talking about APA. You can see here. This is the APA style. You can change that, you know, the way you want from here. And this is the DOI of this paper. So there are a lot of features. We just need to explore all these, you know, features. And this is a free service. And good thing is that that this platform is giving 20 GB free space. You can upload any of data related to your research here. Or in case you want more space, you can just write them. They will increase your space. So this is just a kind of overview about the Fixair. There's a lot of video tutorials are available. Even if somebody is interested, they can explore the video tutorial. I can provide you the link. This is just an overview. And there are many more data repositories like Fixair, where you can make use of this. And here you can see the research data management repository worldwide. You can see this is the re3data.org is in one of the data repository, and you can see India. Oh, you can see India. India is again taking lead on that in that direction. About more than 50 repository they have initiated, and India presence in global. This you can see here 51. The movement is already started. Probably we just need to explore the my idea was just to introduce the concept how the people is, you know, making use of this data repository, and how data research data is important, and as a librarian how we can help our research community in managing and preserving and this research data for reuse. So this is an idea of my presentation, Professor Sinha. Thank you very much. Now I'm open for the all questions.
Sir, we take up question answer at last.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for nicely presenting managing research data using Fixair data repository. And you have covered very important aspect of what are importance of data management, research data life cycle, how we should save data in the repository, what should be the RDM policy, and who are the stakeholder of RDM, and you have also elaborated the Fixair data management repository. And it is a really nice experience listening to you. And really, it will help our scientists, our researcher, budding wellness professional to keep their data safe and also visible. Thank you so much, sir. We will have question and answer last after one more presentation. We will have question and answer. Till then, thank you, sir. Please wait. Now I will request Dr. Anshuman Sen, Director, Computer Center, Assam University, Silchar, to present online teaching learning tools and techniques. Over to Dr. Anshuman Sen, please.
Thank you, Professor M.K. Sinha. I hope I am audible to you, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Sinha. You are the chairman and convener of the organizing chairman and convener of and organizing secretary of this 2x7 days lecture series. And Professor Ramesh C. Gore, Dean and Director, Library and Information Science, also the head Kalanidhi Division, IGNCA, New Delhi. Then my former speakers, Professor Lohkar, retired professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Guwahati University. Also the president of IASLIC. And then Dr. Sanjay Kataria, University Librarian, Bennett University, Greater Noida. Then our speakers, introducer, Mr. Kollol Das, Mr. Omid Oran. Thank you very much for for giving me the opportunity. Now, my former speakers have actually spoken a lot of things about the research methodologies and how to store the research data, how to manage the research data. Then Professor Lohkar has actually spoken about the how to reference the research articles. So, but sir, my things are very simple. I am going to, my point of concern, as you know, I mean, the university people know is that I am the IT enabler of this university. And we are into a very peculiar situation due to this COVID-19 lockdown period. So my point of concern is how to continue the academic activities during this lockdown period, because none of us were expecting what may happen during this lockdown, what may happen during this lockdown, and how to continue this research, our research and the academic activities. So I'm now starting to share the screen of mine. Is my screen view? Is my screen viewable to you, sir?
Please try, sir. It is not coming, sir. Yes, it is now started coming.
Are you able to see my screen, sir?
Yeah, my photograph is coming in this. Sir, you may send to me. I will upload.
Sir, no, it's actually I don't know. I mean, have you not given me the present? Have you not converted me as the presenter, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, we have given, sir. You are the administrator.
But just please bear with me, sir. Let me just do it for you, sir.
Perhaps my screen has been shared, perhaps. Sir, is there any problem, sir?
Hello. Yes, we can see your presentation, sir. That it is visible.
Nahi pada.
Yes, sir, it is coming.
Sir, am I visible and audible to you, sir?
Yes, sir. You are visible.
Okay. Thank you very much. So I hope some technical glitches were there. And as I was saying, my former speakers have actually very nicely spoken about all the research things, research data managed and how it is stored, and then how those research articles are to be referenced. But my things are very simple. I'm going to actually, my point of concern is that how the education is to be continued in during this pandemic period, and with that intention, as an IT enabler of this university, my point of concern is to extend the activities of academic and administrative things to the university fraternity. And with that intention, some tools were given to us, the Cisco WaveX. So that Cisco WaveX I had offered to the academic community, and I hope the academic community has actually, of the university has actually used it in order to impart their teachings to the students. Now, in my discussion today, I shall be focusing on the simple things like what is learning online, online learning, and then what are the types of online learning. You must be all knowing all this. And but for the benefit of the students, because the in absence of the regular time schedule of the university activities, students can really fall onto the various online resources that are available to them, to the university faculty members, which the students can actually use themselves and self-learn. The important point is that because there is a lot of time available to them, so they can self-learn and get some quick certifications, and some certification programs are available, so they can actually fall onto these, and so without depending on the regular academic activities of the university. So what is online learning and advantages of learning online, advantages of teaching online, then the challenges of teaching online. Now, the term online learning, as it is sometimes called the distance learning, include a number of computers. Laptops and smartphones are also included in this, because most of us probably has joined in this particular lecture series using their smartphones also. Some might have joined through their laptops, computers. So all these are, smartphones are nothing but handheld computers only. So online learning is actually assisted instruction methods to laptops and through laptops, smartphones, and computers. Then online teaching is faculty delivered instruction via the internet. Online instruction includes real time, which is synchronous, and a lot of things are available stored in the cloud. So these are asynchronous interaction methods. So students can use those things. Now, two parallel processes take place in an online environment. Students become more active and reflective learners. Generally what happens, the student come to the universities or their colleges, and then they are given some course material, and then after that, they go and then go back and then grab those courses. So here, instead of that, actually they'll have to be proactive and they're reflexive. They'll be active and then reflective learners. Then students and teachers engage in learning through the use of technology and become more familiar with technology by using it. And why online learning? So it enhances students' technological skills. As they continuously use the online learning methodologies, the technological skill of the student increases, then speaking skills of the students also increases. The students who are generally reluctant in asking any questions directly in the classroom, they can actually raise questions in a synchronous method of learning by simply raising their hand, but they have to know the technology how to do that. So that is why probably the shyness of the students actually are removed through this online learning methodology. And forums are anonymous, and student because the forums are anonymous, so students can actually pose relevant or irrelevant questions, but they can speak up their mind. So that is why also online learnings are very important. Now it improves the students' independence. They can, it is really not dependent. They are not dependent on time that they will have to come in a fixed schedule to the universities or the colleges and then attend a particular class. Opens new range of possibilities. There are a lot of things which are open to them now. They can actually, a student of library science can fall for some computer science courses or some economics courses and a lot of other things, because small duration courses are available to them. And then with those courses, they can actually diversify their knowledge from one domain to other domain, which would in fact help them in developing their skills. It is engaging for students as it involves audio and visual. So because we have seen some technologies like say particularly Cisco Webex, through Cisco Webex, a particular teacher can actually pose some small questions in order to find whether a student is active or inactive, and then some small questions and give A, B, C, D, and then within 5 minutes, students have to give a prompt answer to that. By that, actually, they remains always active. Obviously, because it is of because of the technology, it is appealing to the new generation students, because of the learning styles. Sometimes they get very much bored in their chalk and duster kind of physical classroom. From the physical classroom, they get a different way, and then involve themselves in learning their own academic things. Now, it is interactive and relevant. Now, synchronous approaches to online learning. Synchronous learning is instruction and collaboration in real time. Now this thing is going on in real time basis. But supposing you are, Professor Sinha is very keen on exploring everything in the YouTube. So whatever is being discussed today are also available in YouTube. So through YouTube, when they learn and listen to the same things which are being delivered today or previous days, so that becomes asynchronous. Asynchronous learning methods use the time delayed capabilities of the internet. It typically involves tools such as email. Through email, they can be accessed. Then threaded discussions. Then news groups. Now WhatsApp group. Now this WhatsApp group is very common methodology of giving the teaching materials to the students. Each department I have come to know of our university has created a separate WhatsApp group, and in the group all those students are actually included, and then the teachers are also included, and then teachers give their material, give the information to the students that Falana days I am going to take a class. So those things are asynchronous method. Then there can be bulletin boards, notice boards, etc., and file attachments. So asynchronous courses are still instructor facilitated, but are not conducted in real time, which means that the students and teachers can engage in course related activities at their convenience rather than during specifically coordinated class sessions. So it is very clear from the things which are being written here. Thank you. Then advantages of learning online. What are the advantages? Online learning offers variety of educational opportunities. It is student-centered learning. The variety of online tools grows and individual learning styles and helps students to become more versatile learners. And collaborative learning. You see, when you create a group, and as students amongst themselves, they can interact. One can solve the problem of the other. This is collaborative learning. Online group work allows students to become more active. Some groups may be created, and then some projects may be given. And because of this pandemic situation, they cannot meet, but through those group work, they become more active. They feel involved. So that is the advantage. And then contributing inputs require that the students comprehend what is being discussed, organize their thinking coherently, and express their thinking with carefully constructed language. As I already said, when because of the anonymity of the group, sometimes they are very, the reluctant student who was not earlier speaking anything in the class, they will also frame some questions and very carefully they will ask those questions to the group. Then experimental learning through multimedia presentations, then new technologies can be used to engage and motivate the students. Advantages of teaching online. Online teaching can allow teachers to experiment with techniques available online in online environments. Now, online email discussion, a frequently used practice in online learning, can be incorporated in traditional courses to facilitate group work. Now, sample papers posted on the internet with students' permission can easily be incorporated in a traditional course. Now, I wonder, I mean, how many departments are engaged into this? I mean, the regular course papers, previous question papers can be, there can be a small group, and then in the group, the students, relevant students can be included. And then we can, the previous question papers can be actually, can be uploaded there, and then students can take benefit of it. See, our intention, the intention of the teaching learning's methodology is that the overall skill of the students should actually improve in order so that we get the skilled resources and then society is benefited. So our system, with that intention, we have seen the National Education Policy 2020 has come. With the previous set of mindset needs to be changed now. And I'm sure, the way it is going, last 4 months, we have been engaging in the academic activities through online mode. And I'm sure the government of India is also will be started thinking whether when everything is normalized, say 25% or 50% of the course, entire course, can be shifted totally on online or not. Our university, I know, is thinking in that direction, that even if everything normalizes, that it would be made mandatory that 25% of the course material would be always given through online mode. So the things are changing now. Things are changing, and I remember when there was a notbandi, we were actually compulsorily pushed into the internet banking kind of thing. Net banking. All net transactions were being made compulsory. Now, in this lockdown period, we are gradually shifting from the regular academic activities towards the online activity of academic activity. So this is probably our NEP, National Education Policy Transforming India, which our Honorable Prime Minister had inaugurated on 7th of this month, is focusing on that. UGC Chairman had has conducted a conclave on this. So we are actually we are moving towards that direction, and our teacher has to actually cope with that. Now, some of the challenges of the teachers of teaching online. What are the challenges? The biggest challenge is that non-availability of internet in the remote part of the university, remote part of the country. Now, in Assam University, we get a lot of students from remote localities like, Hailakandi or maybe some very rural areas where internet facility is not there. But when you are talking about teaching online, how to cope with, how to address that thing? So in order to address that thing, we know in Cisco Webex, we have when you create a particular classroom session, you get a phone line also. You get two phone numbers, which are Hyderabad and New Delhi based. So a student who is not having any access to internet can remain in touch with the real time classroom, through a phone line, simply a telephone connection, a landline. Enables him to join in a meeting and then get listened to what the teacher is delivering. So these are the few things which are the challenges, but there are methodologies to address those issues as well. overcoming the challenges by adopting techniques, becoming familiar with the technology used in your online course. Now we'll have to be familiar with the technology. See, although I am supposed to promote the Cisco Webex, but here in the beginning of the session, as you could notice, that I encountered some problem in order to be online with you. At least it took five minutes for me to get connected to you. So these are some issues which really have to be have to know, and I'm sure in over a period of time we'll all address those issues and we'll overcome those challenges. Now, effectively structuring the online courses. See, when you I said, say 25% of the course would become compulsorily online. So I am actually what I'm saying is that it would be some kind of blended mode of teaching. Now, some say 50%, which is practical based, would be a physically classroom oriented or laboratory oriented, and then remaining 50% or remaining 25% would be online based. So you will have to structure the course. I mean, the teacher community has to structure this course according to those requirements. That keep connected with your students. It is very mandatory. Now, a new policy says that every, there would be a small group. I mean, in a group of say 40 students, class strength of 40 students, there may be say 5 or 6 groups, and each faculty would be assigned to a group who would be continuously in touch and counsel the students, and so that they do not demotivated. I mean, in order to continuously counsel and motivate them, it would be the responsibility of that concerned faculty to engage them. So now creating community in virtual classrooms. And in a virtual classroom environment also, you can create you can actually create a community, and then facilitating and encouraging the online discussions. And it would have been very nice if I would have actually, when I say something, if I could take some questions from you. But because of the limitations of this particular lecture series, 30 minutes, probably it is not possible. But in a 60 minutes environment, it is really possible. I have myself tested it when I delivered the lecture to them. I actually encouraged the students to actually ask back. In order to know there what is going on. So now blended learning, as I have said, blended learning here, definition of blended learning. Blended learning is a formal educational program in which a student learns at least a part through online delivery of content and instruction with some elements of students' control over time, pace, and place and path. Because you see, it would not be probably wise for the university to give everything on the student. So there has to be some control so that you decide the path and directions of the students in which way they approach a particular course. So there has to be some directions to them, because otherwise they may not be knowing this. So plus at least some part of the face-to-face learning. So face-to-face learning face-to-face learning, then online collaborative learning, and then self-paced learning. This makes the total learning learning of a course by any student. So these are this is what is blended learning, and probably we are gradually moving towards this blended learning technique. I anticipate that over a period of another maybe 2 to 3 years time, we would be really thrown into that kind of blended learning environment. Now, online education cycle. This is asynchronous. I mean, what is education online? Asynchronous, synchronous learning. Time. Real time. Synchronous learning is real time based. Asynchronous, which is stored in the contents are stored in the net, in the internet, and then they can learn. And then learning undertaking on a computer means of the internet, then this is education, then a technical structure. So now, advantages of online learning. Students have the chance to study for free at their time and pace, at their own time and pace. I mean, they will not be dependent on a particular schedule. Like here also today, I can very proudly say I have seen from my admin panel that some of the classes in last 3 months have been taken through Cisco Webex at around say 8:30 at night. Can you imagine such kind of environment in a regular mode? We really cannot. But here I have seen that at 8:30 a.m. also classes are being scheduled, and at 8:30 p.m. also classes are being scheduled, and students are actively participating. So they are really enjoying this new environment. Students, teachers also have to gradually accommodate, adjust into this kind of environment. And access to all resources help participants to learn whether they are leaving the wherever they are, leaving them the freedom to choose the time for study. The change from passive to active active learners, as I have already said, in a classroom kind of environment they are the passive learners, but in an online environment they are active learners. Supposing in this particular workshop, in this particular lecture series, there are about say 90 participants. Here in 90 participants, we really do not know whether all the 90 are really active here or not, because in an online environment the focus is totally the focus is totally on to the students, whether and how they want to learn. And overall emphasis is on giving the skill development of the student. So they become active learners in online mode. The responsibility and self-discipline of the student increases manifold, provides flexibility to learn from anywhere, provided internet is there. And lot of things, a student can be in a terrace of his house, and then get connected to this particular workshop from his mobile. So from anywhere he can learn. So then online degree programs cost less. We all know this. Online degree program cost less than campus-based degree programs, as most of the study materials are available in downloadable formats. So our university will also probably have to think that some of the online degree programs are made available to the students. And a student who is not interested or compelled to leave the study after say 1 year, then and have to join a particular profession, due to his family needs, by engaging himself in some kind of employment, he can also continue his course. So our NEP 2020 really addresses that issue. If I'm not wrong, actually it is 5+3+3+4. So it is being said 4. After 1 year, one student can leave with a certificate. Then at any point of time, he can again come back and he can do his remaining 2 years, get a remaining 1 year, get a diploma, and then again leave and again come back and get his degree, like that. So that can continue. So our NEP 2020 is focused on those kind of things. So now online learning initiatives of Government of India. So as I was saying, there are some Government of India initiatives by MHRD, UGC, inter-university centers. InflipNet is really playing a very heavy role, great role, I would say, in designing the courses, in making the repositories available. Shodh Ganga is available, a lot of other things. So CEC is also doing great things in terms of Swayam Prabha. DTH channels are available. So here are the online resources which are available for the students to self-learn. Swayam online courses, UG, PG, MOOCs, EPG Pathshala, National Digital Library, E-Gyan Kosh, which is a national repository created by Open Learning University. I think IGNU has created it. Then NPTEL, he is IIT Mumbai, project, and a lot of engineering courses are available online, and one can actually join those course and the give an examination and get a certification. And there are grade points are possibility of converting those grade points to a regular course is also available in that. So then Diksha is there for UGC, NAT, JRF, facilities of mock tests are available in Diksha. It is all focused on self-learning of the students. Then Shodh Ganga is available, our chairman of the session actually had focused on this Shodh Ganga. Shodh Ganga is also available. This is also a great effort by InfliptNet Center. Now it is mandatory for the university MPhil and PhD degree, whosoever is awarded, their research material have to be uploaded in the Shodh Ganga, so that these great resources are available to the others, and there is no duplication. What is the purpose? Some research is going on in Assam University, and the same kind of research is going on in, say, Gujarat. So it is a kind of duplication. Actually, without knowing what is going on in Assam University, Gujarat University is doing the same thing. So so now these kind of things are being eliminated with the available of Shodh Ganga. And Swayamprabha, these are DTH 24/7 DTH channels. CEC, UGC, YouTube channels are there. Shodh Sindhu is also an online resource available to the students. Now, Swayam online courses provide access to teaching learning resources. These resources are delivered on the Swayam platform. Students may register on Swayam, swayam.gov.in, and can continue their learning as usual. The courses are available for engineering, non-engineering, certificate and diploma courses. Students can self-learn. Student can self-learn programming. Tools are available there. Conduct scientific experiments virtually. Learn open source software for education. Read e-books, etc. So this is the link. Student can directly, links are also made available here. I hope it will open. Yeah. So Swayam online courses, you can see here, engineering courses are available. Non-engineering courses are available, say, for the benefit of the students of this particular lecture series. I am hoping that many students from the Department of Library and Information Science has joined this. So I click this non-engineering. I hope it will open. Yeah, so it has opened. So now in this, you see, lot of these courses are available. So information source, management of libraries and information centers and knowledge centers. Let us click on this. So select a module. So they will have to select, the entire course is designed here, you see, for this particular management of library and information sciences. 64 modules are there. So say let us select a module, say course introduction video, and they go on to this video. And this is very all experts are being called by Government of India, and their materials are available.
Video pose is a problem. Stop sharing. Next, get the data on it.
So this is the way one can actually approach the SWAYAM online courses. Then UGPG MOOCs. Here also there are it is UGC MOOCs, Infibnet.ac.in. Infibnet is offering some courses here. Again, you see, 128 PG courses are available and 232 UG courses are available. And here I have seen that the librarian information science is also included. So apart from the regular class lectures and regular lectures of our distinguished faculty of librarian information science, Assam University, they can also take benefit of what is available in free of cost at their at those resources. So they can go there and they can actually learn to them. So anywhere they can go and they can select. You see here it is e-texts are available. Now students can get e-texts. All e-texts are available and they can also self-learn. Self-learn again going by this video. So this is about UGPG MOOCs. Then there is EPG Pathshala. EPG Pathshala is an initiative of MHRD under the NMEICT being executed by UGC. EPG Pathshala hosts high quality curriculum based interactive e-content containing 23,000 modules, e-texts and videos in 70 postgraduate disciplines of social sciences, arts, fine arts and humanities, natural and mathematical sciences. So this is the link, they can go there. Diksha platform is there where there are facilities students may explore. National Digital Library is also there to make available to the learners community learning resources through a single window. NMEICT sponsored the NDLI project and arranged funding through MHRD. Purpose is to develop a framework of virtual repository of learning resources with a single window search facility. Filtered and federated searching is employed to facilitate focused searching. You see, all these tools are being developed by the experts and by their domain experts. Whatever is available in the e-resources are actually given by the domain experts. And so students would be getting the best of the best, you know, in the form of e-resources e-learning resources. Shodh Ganga, I think we all know, particularly library people would be knowing it better. I mean, our Professor Manas Sinha is the nodal officer of this Shodh Ganga of Assam University. Through Shodh Ganga, and the purpose is that the resources are being made available to the students, and there is no duplicacy. I mean, our professor, previous speaker, has very aptly said that the purpose is not to catch what is being plagiarized. Purpose is that. That somehow the research on the same topic is being avoided because we get the maximum thing, you know, for the benefit of the society. Purpose of doing any research, yeah, it is for the best interest of the student and the best interest of the supervisor, I understand. But at the end of the day, the research content goes to the society, you know, and so with that purpose, Shodh Ganga is has been given to us. So thank you all. With this, I conclude. I know it may not be a very of great importance to you, but this is my way of giving the things. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for nicely presenting online teaching learning tools and techniques. And you have covered in detail the concept, advantage and disadvantages, and various learning resources available through various means. You have also discussed National Digital Library of India, Sodh Ganga, and all types of courses available through MOOC. I hope our students, researchers, they will be getting benefit out of it. And it was a really nice session, wonderful lecture from all the experts. Now I will request our chairman of the session, Professor Ramesh Chandra, if he is available. Now he can conclude the session.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. I will not be very comfortable because I'm driving right now.
Okay, sir.
But I can just share a few comments. Like first thing, these are very, very important and useful presentation you have made. And I think particularly various kind of information shared in these lectures will definitely be very useful for the students. At the same time, I think my suggestion is that after these lectures, students should be given some assignments based on these lectures. Because until unless you rework, re-practice, you don't properly learn something. Lectures are good, but if it is not supported by proper hands-on or proper assignments and proper reading, some suggested reading, as I had talked about various UGC regulations, and all speakers have talked about various kind of data repository. Like when Dr. Kataria was talking about various repository like Figshare and other repository, so the student should be given an assignment to identify which are the important repository and how to create a data repository, self-archiving repository. Similarly, when we talk about plagiarism, many people don't know how to analyze the similarity reports. What are the exclusions Professor Lakar has explained, different kind of styles. But now these styles are very much possible to take care with the help of Mendeley, EndNote or Zotero. So some kind of hands-on. So what my suggestion is that theoretical lecture supported by some good hands-on and a kind of assignments. So that helps students to learn. If they do themselves, then it is learned. And in terms of online teaching, MOOC platform. So basically, like if they can develop certain kind of integration of these all MOOC platform available in the field of library science or different subject discipline. So some kind of project work related to these lectures to the students will be very, very helpful. So I think these were my last comments, and thank you very much for inviting me and sharing a wonderful program with the participants. And this is a right tribute to our father of library science, Dr. S.R. Ranganathan. I thank all the speakers for wonderful presentations and very, very important knowledge sharing sessions. All are very experienced, and I'm sure this hard work in organizing this workshop will be very, very useful. So I think these comments, once again, thank you very much and all the best.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for sharing this session and giving your valuable comments and suggestions. We will definitely follow all these suggestions, sir. And now I would like to request Sri Amit Rao to please take up some questions if participant have posted some question in chat box. You can see if there are some question you can take, and finally you offer vote of thanks. Amit Rao, please. Are you available, Amit?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, you can start now. Okay. Is there anything you can see? And you can ask the respective resource person.
Question answer, actually, sir, in my mobile, it is visible.
Okay. Okay, some questions I could see here.
Sir,
Rajesh, you can ask directly. You have written some questions here.
Yes, sir. I got two questions.
Yes.
So, first of all, we will take some questions. First question is from Rajesh Rangapal Allarpi. This question is directed to, I think, the chairman, sir, that is Ramesh Chandra Gaur, sir. As per UGC latest regulation, excluding 14 continuous words from similarity detection report is it justifiable? And is it necessary to fix exclusion of words based on the detection software coverage?
Yeah, thank you. This is a very valid and important question. It is because many people are not really aware of the exact meaning of these 14 consecutive words. What happened, when you check a similarity report, there are a number of coincidental terms. There is certain things called common knowledge. So these 14 words, like internationally, anything beyond 4 consecutive words need to be cited. That's the international practice. But 14 consecutive words have been given a kind of exclude on the basis of, you have to add coincidental terms and common knowledge. Give you an example. A science student is doing certain, and he or she is using common materials and methods. So there are two different studies, but there is a common materials and methods used. So there are chances of similarities between two studies. So these 14 consecutive words are justified in case of coincidental, common knowledge, and certain things which are unavoidable. If these 14 consecutive words are not for, like, suppose you copy something from somewhere and you are allowed to copy 14 consecutive words. That is not the understanding. So clarification, my clarification is that you can leave 14 consecutive words, but it should be coincidental, common knowledge, and should be something which is unavoidable. Only that is allowed as a 14 consecutive words. Otherwise, copying is not allowed. I think it is clear to him now.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I think the question is answered. The next question is from Anuradha Maurya, I think. This question is already answered in the chat box. Sanjay Kataria, sir, has already answered the chat box only.
Sir, so, please explain. Sanjay Kataria, yes, sir, please explain again.
Yeah, I already replied the questions. He was asking about can they interact with the people like another social media, academy or research gate. Yes, once scholar is going to start this uploading the research data, certainly they can collaborate, can understand, can see that, you know, follow each other's. Or they, in case somebody is found somewhere very close to your work, you can peer, you can collaborate with them for further, you know, and can share your research data. So this kind of platform is really useful and adding value.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your response. And now we have completed the question answer session. Now,
hello. You can offer vote of thanks.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now we have reached at the final stage of today's program, day 3 program. So this is the time of formal vote of thanks. First of all, I would like to thank our honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Dilip Chandra Nath, Vice Chancellor Assam University of Silchar, for all his support in this program. Next, I would like to thank our today's chairman of the session, Dr. Ramesh Chandra Gaur, Dean, Director, Bring and Information, Head Colonization, IGNC, Delhi. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing this session And thank you very much for your introductory speech. Now I would like to thank our speakers, Professor Narendra Lahkar sir, and Dr. Sanjay Kataria sir, and Dr. Angshuman Sen sir. Okay, so Professor Narendra Lahkar sir, he spoke on the topic academic writing, referencing, and plagiarism. He explained all the aspects of this topic very nicely. So thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful presentation. Next, Dr. Sanjay Kataria, sir, he has also explained very well on the topic managing research data using six-year data repository. His topic was based on the six-year data repository, and this was really interesting, and we all are benefited from this. So thank you very much, sir. And next speaker was Dr. Angshuman Sen, sir. Director of Computer Center, Assam University, and his lecture was on online teaching learning tools and techniques. And this topic is very much important nowadays because online teaching learning is going on during this pandemic time. So he explained very well the tools and techniques for online teaching learning. So thank you very much, sir. Now I would like to thank our organizing secretary, Professor Manoj Kumar Sinha, sir. He is the sole person behind this program. Without him, this program was not possible. So thank you very much, sir, for all your efforts. Now I would like to thank our joint organizing secretary, Dr. Mukut Sharma, sir, for his support. And also I thank Dr. Sumana Chakravarti Sharma, madam. She is also joint organizing secretary in this program. So thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to thank our reporter general, Dr. Naveen Chandra Day, sir. And thank you very much, sir, for your support. And now I thank all the assistant organizing secretaries, Dr. Apurva Jyoti Majumdar, Mr. Rajesh Rangappa Aldarsi, Mr. Kalul Das Talukdar. So thank you everyone for your support. And now I would like to thank our technical support team, Mr. Manjit Singha and Mr. Tushar Manish Sinha. So thank you very much for all your technical support. Because from this on the technical online this and the technical support was very much important. Thank you very much. And at last, but not the least, I thank all the participants from all over the country for their participation. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, and thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Amit, for nicely offering vote of thanks and conducting the question answer session. Now, with this, we conclude today's day three program. And feedback link will be given to all participants through email or WhatsApp. They are required to fill up. And from tomorrow, four-day session will be started at 11 a.m. All are requested to be there. And all participants are requested to attend the program. We are giving links on YouTube also. And there will be some quiz at the end of the program. So we carefully listen all the lecture and note down important points. There will be some quiz questions we will ask at the end of the program. So all should attempt and all should sincerely attend the session. One information I want to share that few of our participants, they have registered themselves, but they have uploaded instead of receipt, fee receipt, money receipt, he has given PAN card, a certificate, something like that. An arbitrary number is also given in UPR ID. So we have already allowed them to attend, but if they have paid the registration fee, they can again upload the original registration receipt so that it can be reconciled. And by mistake, they might have uploaded, I don't know. But those who have not submitted session fee, they kindly submit and send e-receipt to email ID, organizer's email ID. With this, I extend my sincere thanks to all, to the chairman, to the honorable vice chancellor, sir, to the chairman of the session, all the speakers of today's event, all the committee members, and all the participants. So thank you so much. I think today's program is finished here, and we conclude this. Thank you. Thank you so much to all.
Thank you, Professor Sinha, for your kind invitation. Dr. Rajesh, Professor Lakshman, thank you very much. All organizing team member Tushar, all the best.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Really thanks to you, sir, and all the speakers. It was a new topic for us, and it was an opportunity to learn the new thing from you. You have given the links. We'll explore the links and we'll try to learn from that. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Rajesh. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kaur. Thank you very much.
Thanks to Abhishek Sinha also. He has also supported when Tushar's class was going on. Abhishek Sinha has taken the charge of giving technical support.
Thanks to Abhishek Sinha.
Okay, sir. Sir.
Thank you.
Good day. Okay. All this. Thank you. Namaste. Thanks a lot for joining.
Okay, sabhi ko namaskar. Thank you.
Namaskar.
We'll see you tomorrow. Sir, we will be sending links for all the days. If you have time, you can attend, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Mukul Sharma. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks, we should log out now.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Bye.